Welcome to the God Only Encouraging Message and Prayer Series. Messages from the heart of God to let you know you can come boldly to the throne of grace to receive mercy for your failures and find grace to help in good time for every need. That appropriate help and well-timed help coming just when you need it. Listen, God wants you to know with absolute certainty that the Lord makes a way for you even when you think there is no way possible. The Lord Jesus is your way maker. Jesus tells you, with man, things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Matthew 19:26. In part one of this series, you'll remember that the Lord had said to Abraham, I will return to you about this time next year, and your wife Sarah will have a son. Sarah was listening to the conversation from the tent, and Abraham and Sarah were both well advanced in years, and Sarah was long past the age of bearing children. So she laughed silently to herself and said, how could an old worn-out woman like me enjoy such pleasure, especially when my master, my husband, is also old? Then the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? Why did she say, can an old woman like me have a baby? That's Genesis 18:10-13. Then listen what God said in Genesis. It's the same thing he's telling you in Matthew 19. Is anything too hard for the Lord? And that's what he's telling you. Is anything too hard for the Lord to do for you? Is there anything impossible that God can't do for you? The answer is no. And he wants to do it for you. Just as he said to Abraham, I will return about this time next year, and Sarah will have a son. Listen, the Lord kept his word to Sarah and Abraham, and he did exactly what he promised. Sarah became pregnant, and she bore Abraham a son in his old age, and it happened just at the exact same time that God said it would. And they named the son Isaac because it means laughter. For God had promised to do what was impossible for an old man that's 99 years old and Sarah, who's 90, to have a child of their own. But God is the way maker. The Lord is the way maker. And he made a way for them to fulfill his promise to Abraham and Sarah to be the father and the mother of many nations. Listen, you can know, as Job did, that God can do anything, and there's nothing that can be helped from his purpose. There's no thought. There's nothing can restrain him or thrall him for absolutely accomplishing what he wants to accomplish. He even tells you in Isaiah 55:11 that the word that I put out there, my word is filled with power, he tells you, and it will not return unto me void. That means empty and without accomplishing what he meant for intended for it to go out and do. God makes his word true to you, and his word is Christ himself, Jesus himself. And so his word is the image of the invisible God who is the way maker, and it's the way maker that makes the way. Jesus brings you a refreshing to your life. He brings a way where it seems like there can be no way. He makes streams in the deserts, and he shines his light in darkness to prove and to show that he is close to you and helping you. So he tells you, wait patiently on the Lord for your help. He hears your cries. He knows what it is that you have need of. He knows when you're in a pit of despair and you're despondent and you're depressed and you're anxious and you're worried. He knows how to get you out of the mud and the mire and to set your feet on solid ground steadfast so that you can walk along with him and trust in him and depend on him. And then he says, I give you another song. I give you another song to sing in your heart. He says to you, many will see what he has done And he will be amazed at what God did for you. God wants to show through you that he's a way maker for you, no matter what your situation, circumstance is in life. And he'll put his stamp on you, whom he sealed with his Holy Spirit, and others will be able to trust in him because he was a way maker for you. So today we're going to look at three more people in Scripture that God had to have them depend on him and trust in him to make a way, because there was no way for them to survive without God overcoming insurmountable odds for them. So as you listen to what God did for these, how he made a way for each one of these, realize that God says, the Lord himself, the way maker himself, Jesus Christ, says, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. God does not change. He will help you just as he helped these, even in times like we're living in. Therefore, you can come boldly to God's throne of grace when you are feeling lost and weary and without options, and hear God's promise for you as we listen to what these others had heard. Behold, I'm doing a new thing for you. He's talking to you. This is the scripture that he gave at the beginning of the year to lead us into 2020. And he is doing new things. He says, now it springs up for you. Do you not see it? Do you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert for you. God's telling you that no matter what your situation or circumstance is right this very moment, he knows what you need before you ask him. And he's already telling you he's making a new way for you even before you knew you needed a new way. So all throughout scriptures, time and time again, God demonstrates himself as the faithful Savior who shows up and makes a way when there is no possible way in human reasoning or power for it to happen. It's all God and not man. It's God who is the way maker, not man. So the Lord has made a way, and he will make a way for you. If you remember in our first episode here, the king Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold, and he set it up on a plain in Jura in the province of Babylon. And the king sent to all his satraps and his prefects and his governors and his counselors and his treasurers, justices and magistrates and all the officials of the province, to come to the dedication of the image that the king had set up of himself. And when they gathered for the dedication, if you remember, the image stood about 90 feet tall, and that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. He commanded all the people and all the nations and all the languages that he ruled over to fall down and worship the golden image of himself that he had set up when the horns blew. And whoever didn't fall down and worship immediately would be cast into a fiery furnace. That's Daniel 3, 1 through 6. Therefore, there's Chaldeans, and at that certain time, they recognized that there was three Jewish boys that did not bow down. And they went and told Nebuchadnezzar. And they did it deceitfully. They said, O king, live forever. There are certain Jews whom you've appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O God, pay no attention to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. Nebuchadnezzar became furious, and he commanded Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to be brought before him. And when he did, he asked him, I said, is it true that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image I've set up? And they responded, No king, O King Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire and the furnace. He will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. They were making a declaration with their very life on the line, saying, we are not going to serve another god and these lesser gods, because only the God of Israel, the God of gods and the King of kings, the Lord God himself is God. There is no other. So Nebuchadnezzar was so filled with rage that he heated up the furnace 7 times hotter than usual, and he bound Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in all their cloaks and their turbans and everything, and he had them thrown into the fiery furnace. But the people that threw them in, they actually burned immediately and died. And when Nebuchadnezzar looked and he saw the images of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, he said, wait a minute, there's another image that's like the Son of God in there with them. And they have been unbound, and they're walking around in the furnace. And the furnace is not touching them. The fires are not hurting them. And these three men were bound, but now they're unbound. Now God is with them. The angel of God is with them. And Nebuchadnezzar commanded them, come out. Come out. He said, come out, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And when he did, and they walked out of the fiery furnace, there was no fire on them. There is nothing. There is no smoke. The hairs of their head was not singed. The cloaks were not burned. They were not harmed. And there is no smell of fire upon them. So Nebuchadnezzar turned to them, and he said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants, who trusted in him and set aside the king's command and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own God. Therefore, he made a decree that every person, any people, nation, and tongue and language should not speak against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or else they'll be torn limb from limb and their houses laid in ruins, for there is no other God who is able to rescue this way except their God. God made a way, and God makes a way for you. As a matter of fact, in Isaiah 43:2-3, the Lord promised to make a way. He says, the Lord promises to make a way for you. He says to you, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overwhelm you. Listen to what he said, because they knew this to be true of their God, because they had known the stories about their God protecting them and protecting their people all throughout history. And he said to them, when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned or torched, nor will the flame kindle upon you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. And that's Isaiah 43:2-3. So God made a way for Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. And he makes a way for you out of the fiery furnaces in your life. And if you pay close attention, he's telling you something in the story, is that he was with them. God is with you, just as he is with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. He's with you presently now. The Lord has come to live in you. Your body's the temple of the living God, and God is with you presently now. The Son of God is with you. So trust in him. Then if you remember, and the next episode that happened is that King Darius had taken over the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians. And he had been deceived by his administrators and officials and high officers and advisors and governors that the king should make a law that be strictly enforced to find a charge against Daniel concerning the law of God to remove him from office and kill him. So King Darius assumed that Daniel was in agreement with the orders that had been given over the next 30 days that any person who prays to anyone divine or human except to King Darius, that they would be thrown in the den of lions. And to make it absolutely unbreakable, they sealed it with the official law of the Medes and the Persians that cannot be revoked. And so Daniel was thrown into the lion's den. But the God sent his angel and shut the lion's mouth so that they could not hurt Daniel. He made a way for Daniel. He sent his angel to shut the mouth. He sent his son to shut the mouth of the angel, and shut the mouth of the lions. It was God present with him in the son, in the presence of an angel. Just like it was the Son of God present with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the presence of the fire. God was present with Daniel in his messenger. And he said to Daniel, I will protect you. I will protect you. So Daniel knew God being with him, everything was fine for him. And then it became true that King Darius was so upset with himself that he prayed for Daniel all night long. And as soon as daybreak got there, even before, he was running to the den of lions and he was calling out to Daniel, 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 are you safe? Are you safe? Are you safe? And Daniel answered and said to him, O King Darius, live forever. My God has closed the mouth of the lions, for I was innocent, and I was found innocent in his sight, and I have not wronged you, your majesty. For God shut the mouth of the lions for Daniel, who was in the den all night long, so he could be a living testimony to the faithfulness of almighty power of God in his life. And that's what God does for you. He is your way maker to be a testimony for him about his power for you. Just as God was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, God is with you. Just as God was with Daniel in the lion's den, God is with you in the den that you face this day. God is the one who made the way of escape for Daniel. He's the one who makes a way of escape for you. In our next episode, God wanted to show compassion to the people of Nineveh and give them the opportunity to turn from their evil ways and to love him who created them and to obey him. God commanded Jonah to go to Nineveh and tell them to repent or perish. But Jonah didn't want to do that. Jonah turned and went the other direction. And he boarded a ship, and it sailed away from the direction of Nineveh. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea. And there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was threatened to breaking up. Then the mariners, who were afraid, and each cried out to his God. And they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it. But Jonah was asleep. He was asleep in the inner part of the ship. And he was fast asleep, as it tells you in Jonah 1, 4, and 5. So the captain yelled out to Jonah, and he told him, call out to your God to rescue us. But Jonah remained silent, for he already had told the crew that he was running from the Lord. Finally, Jonah convinced the crew to just throw him overboard. But the crew didn't want innocent blood on their hands because they didn't know what Jonah had done. So when they did throw him over, the storm stopped and the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights, as it says in Jonah 1:17. Listen, Daniel being in the lion's den for a night is terrifying. But being in the belly of a big fish for 3 days and three nights with no escapes, with water, it says, close over him to take his life, That means he's about to drown any minute. And the deep surrounded him with weeds wrapped around his head, as it says in Jonah 2, 1 and 5. Listen, he's in bad, bad shape. His life is about to be taken. But notice, God made a way for the mariners when they threw Jonah, who was running from God, overboard. The wind stopped and the sailors were saved. But notice that God is also preserving Jonah. He's making a way for Jonah to be preserved. He's keeping him from drowning. And even though he has seaweed wrapped around his head, he's living in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. And God is preserving his life even when he disobeyed God. And God preserves your life also, even when you're disobeying him, because he's faithful to you. That doesn't mean he endorses what you're doing. What it means is that he is watching over you and taking care of you, and he wants the best for you, and he'll move you from what you're doing to move you to where you should go, just as he did with Jonah. Well, when Jonah was in the belly of the fish, listen, that's when he learned something very important. And it's important for us when we're going through difficulties and situations and circumstances. He began to praise and thank God. And when he did, he cried out and said, "What I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord." And he did it with voices of thanksgiving. He remembered his life. God did. And he saved him. And the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah up on dry land within 3 days' walk of Nineveh. Then the Lord came to Jonah the second time and said, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah went according to the word of the Lord, and now Nineveh was saved. It took 3 days for him to walk through Nineveh. And he cried out, "Yet 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown." The people of Nineveh and the king of Nineveh believed God, and they proclaimed a fast with sackcloths, from the greatest to the least of them. When God saw what they had done, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster he had planned for them, and he didn't do it. God made a way for Jonah to have a second chance. God made a way for Nineveh to be saved. And God made a way for the people of Nineveh to be saved. All because he saved Jonah. By making a way for Jonah, he saved the mariners and the people of Nineveh. And God got a blessing and a testimony. God makes a way when there is no way. Especially when it deals with repentance and salvation. God's making ways for you right now. If you've made mistakes, God's making a way for you. We are all have been sinners, and we're saved by grace. It's God's work, not our own. God looks at us, and he loves us. And he demonstrated that love for us, that even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, that God made a way for us. His name is Jesus Christ. And if you will accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can know that God has a way planned for you that's way better than the plan you have for yourself. So you can look to God and know that no matter what time you live in, no matter what trials you face, adversity, hunger, broken relationships, financial issues, addictions, illnesses, it doesn't matter. God is in control, and he's with you. He's guiding you and directing you, and he will help you in all the affairs of life. Listen, your Father knows the things that you have need of even before you ask him, and he makes a way for you to come to him, to demonstrate his great love for you and his grace towards you, and to show you his protection and safety and salvation. God is your helper. God is your way maker. He watches over you. He watches over you like dear lambs, and he's your shepherd. He protects you, and he cares for your needs. He helps you turn to him and believe in him by divinely persuading you that he is for you and with you and helps you in all the affairs of life. So quit striving to handle everything on your own. Quit striving to make things right on your own. You can't do it. God is in control of the situation, and he wants you to depend and trust on him with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but acknowledge and be thankful that he is with you and he's working for you and through you and helping you in all the affairs of life. And then you will see the escape that Jonah saw because God made a way. You'll see the escape that Daniel saw because God made a way. You'll see the escape that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego made because God makes the way of escape for you. God doesn't want to leave you where you're at, and he wants you to escape to where he has planned for you, to be in his life and his life in you, because greater is he in you and you in him than you can imagine, because he loves you. Because he loves you, he gives you this promise. I will be with you always. I will never abandon you. I will never forget you. And I will never leave you by yourself. Trust in me, and I will be there for you no matter what. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.